The second talk of the morning. So Noriyuzuka is going to tell us about the exact particle for 3D quantum gravity. Before we start, just one announcement that after this talk, we'll just take a group picture just outside here. Okay, so please hang on for a few minutes and take a picture. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. So I pass to everybody, I want to thank the organizer for inviting me to this wonderful workshop, especially Shinji for this whole arrangement. So today I want to talk about the last paper which I did with my colleague. So first I should advertise the young fellows who is looking for the job. So this paper, I mainly talk about this paper which is written like 2 years ago with collaboration with Terashima at the Yukawa Institute. And then Tanaka, he was a PhD student of our university, and now he gets a postdoc in Iken. And after writing our paper, he finished doing theoretical physics, especially string theory, and he switched into the machine learning subject. Okay. And then another guy, Masazumi Honda, he's doing the postdoc at the Weizmann Institute, and he's actually applying for the postdoc this year, and he's doing good. But mainly I'm talking about the main paper, which is written without Honda in this paper. And then the two follow-up paper, which is generalization in some sense of this previous paper into higher spin gravity. But basically, I first focus on the shipless spin gravity in the first paper. So this is that one. Okay, so introduction. So the first question I want to ask to people who is interested in the gravity is that, can we really calculate the quantum gravity partial function? Okay, the answer should be yes or no, obviously. Okay. I'm sure some of them think the answer must be yes. Okay, fine. I have the cheapest solution for the yes. Yes, define quantum gravity non-perturbatively by the dual field theory. Okay, this is the cheapest way. Because then all of the quantum gravity problem is gone. Because all of the problem we have to deal with is simply quantum field theory. Solve it non-perturbatively. And it just gives the definition of the quantum gravity in the book. All of the problem of the quantum gravity is gone by this way. So that's why I say it's somehow cheap. Because it's not fully satisfactory. Because we don't directly deal with the gravity issue. So we are assuming several things because. So what is the big assumption? If you say we can solve the quantum gravity from the boundary theory, we are assuming hologram. Okay? As everybody agree, this is a big assumption. We need large n, okay? Strong coupling limit. And even given that, we do not know when, how, and why the bulk picture emerges at all. Only the several situation where we have the deep brain construction, we know, take the large n, back reacted, have the geometry, and that's a dual. Okay, that's what Alexander did. But generically, given the CFD, do we have the bulk description? How the bulk geometry emerges? We do not know, okay, generically. So there are several details. So I say no, doing the bulk directly is more interesting. Doing from the boundary viewpoint is somehow cheating because we don't handle the gravity problem at all directly. So I say no, we cannot conduct the direct calculation of the bulk side due to several obstacles. Okay? What is the problem? We have the non-linearizability of the quantum gravity compared to the quantum field theory, unboundedness of the bulk action, meaning that the Einstein-Hilbert action can go from minus infinity to plus infinity. We do not know how to deal with it. Of course, the existence of black hole solution, okay, maybe for the partial integration or the partial function, it doesn't matter, but once you have the black hole, does it have the smooth geometry inside the horizon or not? This is unsolvable. Okay? And so in geometry, you have to sum over all of the geometry, given the boundary. How do you deal with this? So, in this talk, we try to do the direct calculation of the quantum gravity partial function under several assumptions, of course. Why we need several assumptions is because we do not know how to define the gravity directly. Okay? But at least we expect, at least in classical limit, we obtain such and such result and so on. So we justify how much assumption we need and how much non-trivial result we obtain by directly trying to calculate the partial function. Okay. So in this talk, we try to calculate the pure gravity, quantum gravity partial function in 2 plus 1 dimension, but I will do that in the Euclidean, so it's a 3D bulk. So why do we 3D? Oh, it's simplest. Okay. No graviton. Still black hole exists, so it's interesting enough. And I think this is one of the big problems. Why we have difficulty to do the bulk directly in the periodicity? It's simply one reason. One of the main reasons is that we do not know explicitly no string theory compactification to obtain pure gravity. We know how to obtain, how to compactify the string theory from 10 dimensional to 11 dimensional to obtain 2 plus 1 dimensional gravity with matter. But we can do that. Okay. But we do not know directly how to obtain, say, 2 plus 1 dimensional pure gravity from string theory compactification. No one does. Once we know how to do that, we probably have a hope what should be the term field theory, but we do not know this. And this is probably the main reason why understanding pure gravity is so difficult. One possibility is that pure gravity as a consistent quantum theory of the gravity does not exist, meaning that its dual doesn't exist. That's one possibility. Okay? So before going to the detail, let me review what is a 3D pure gravity, what we know so far. Okay? What we know so far is that there's a BGC black hole solution, as I said. I take the 8 times g newton to be 1 unit always, just for simplicity. So this is a BGC black hole, okay? We have mass, angular momentum, that's it, no charge. Because there is a charge, flux cannot escape, it gives a log kind of the back reactive geometry. Okay? So several conditions, mass should be positive, okay? And further, my use is angular momentum, m should be bigger than j, m equals j is the extremal limit, temperature goes to 0, if m is bigger than j, singularity is hidden behind the horizon. Okay. So let's consider angular momentum zero case for simplicity. Okay. This is a metric. Black hole exists only m is bigger than zero. And now look at this metric and simply we plug in m to be just minus one. Now this is not allowed for the black hole. Okay. So we should plug in naively m to be minus one. This metric simply becomes purely ADS3. Okay. It's just possible. So what we learn? What we learn from this analysis of the BGC black hole is that the black hole exists n greater than 0, but n equal minus 1 is a purely ADS3, so that's a vacuum. And there's an energy gap. Okay. So what do we learn? So we say m is minus 1, so this is a Hamiltonian, or energy is a boundary viewpoint. Now time of the boundary and time of the bulk is identified. Since we have the state-state correspondence, okay. If we have the dual theory, its energy is zero or bigger is BGC black hole spectrum. If energy is, I said, 8 g newton to be 1, so minus 1 is a and there's a gap in between. Since in purely ADS3, there's no particle that exists as a sinus geometry, so there's a big gap. Okay. So that's a well-known measurement. So how do you draw this problem? Okay. So our strategy for functionality problem. So we start with a 3D pure gravity in the bulk. Now this is not the bulk, this is just bulk gravity set. Now it is well known that this 3D bulk gravity classical action at least can be written in terms of the same bulk 3D chance angle. Okay? This is classical equivalence. Okay? Not the quantum equivalence. Classically, this action can be written in terms of chance angle. Now, this theory, we can still solve it. But furthermore, this theory is topological. You can make it supersymmetric without introducing any dynamical degrees of freedom. So once we obtain this theory with supersymmetry, we have full control of the theory. And then we can use many of the techniques people developed, like localization. And then from this result, okay, how much we can reproduce the expected result of the quantum gravity partition function of the 3D? That is a question we want to understand in this approach. Okay, that's a question.
A quick question. So you mentioned unboundedness of the Einstein
action. Yes.
So what happens when you map this to 3D Einstein?
Okay, that's a general. In 3D case, because the solution is highly restricted, only the possibility is that the Einstein-Hilbert action, which is scalar, is equal to the cosmological constants times metric. That's all possibility. Because it's 3D, there's no problem with the general decision at all. Because as other you stick to the classical cosmological solution, R is always proportional to the cosmological constant times metric. But if you do the offshore of the first integration, then you can take from minus 1
dependency, you need to grasp it. And that's the issue of the quantum gravity.
So this equivalence is not an off-shell equivalence?
It's the classical action, so it's a classical
on-shell.
Classical on-shell, you have to.
And so this unboundedness is from the conformal mode, is it?
Yes, exactly. So there's a way to regulate by analytic continuation.
The other question is that when you supersymmetrize this theory, are you also introducing additional boundary degrees of freedom?
Exactly. That's a point. Mm-hmm.
And this is the minimal amount of supersymmetry? Or?
Yeah, minimum amount. Okay, super. Okay, so at least this is a strategy. We do not know how to justify what is the appropriate measure to define quantum gravity, but by taking this approach from the result, we ask how much our assumption for the measure to define quantum gravity is reasonable. So that's a question we have to ask. Okay? That's it so far. Okay. So this is already I mentioned. So punchline, we will show you that the 3D chance time theory, we calculate by localization, and then this has for the specific central charge. I explain why this is interesting. We obtain some of the known results. That's what I want to show you. And as Schmidt pointed out, there's some subtle issue of the boundary degrees of freedom, and that involves a bit more if she is bigger than 24. That's what I want to talk about. So, from my talk so far is that we have done introduction, quick 3D gravity overview is done. So from now I talk about what people done before. So like 10 years ago, we can propose what could be the pure gravity dual over the 3D case. That's what I'm gonna give you. And then we do our strategy, as integration approach by the organization with some introducing non-dynamical parameter matter. And then how much we can reproduce what we expected from that written proposal. And then compare and then discuss. That's it. Okay? No questions so far? Okay, so 3D gravity overview continues. So before the weekend argument, so our theory is 3D pure gravity. As I mentioned, nobody knows how to compactify string theory to obtain pure 3D gravity. We know 3D gravity with junk or matter, but nobody knows. Okay. So 3D gravity is Einstein-Hilbert. With negative cosmic constant, in order to make the theory well defined, we need Gibbons Hawking boundary time to have the direct boundary condition, and then to make theory regulated, we need some counterfactual. Okay, that's it. This is wrong. It is space, negative cosmic constant, and this is the Gibbons Hawking term, boundary term, to regulate the action. Okay, so this is known almost 30 years ago, 40 years ago, whatever it is. So, actually, Carroll and Townsend pointed out that. Okay, so ADA3 in the Euclidean signature is SO3, 1. Okay? Change the variable of the gravity from metric into, it's an spin connection. Okay? So, we have two dynamical wave freedom. Normally, spin connection is written in terms of derivative of the wave gain, but that is, if you do the equation motion for the spin connection is written in terms of the derivative of the wave. So the dynamical wave freedom is, at this moment, spin connection and wave gain. Equation motion of spin connection gives a relation between this and this. Okay? So these two waves of freedom will be related in the following. This is what I did, this is what J.S.J.J. did long time ago. Okay? So in the case of the SO3, 1, it's locally the same as SO3, 2, C. Okay? We don't care so much about the global structure for a moment. Okay? So now we make the SO3, 2, C as complex version of the SU2, okay? SU2 and SU2, both with a complex coefficient in the SU2 generator. And then we have a Pauling matrix from SU2. Take this map and that define what we call A and A bar. This is just definition. Okay? No deal. But the surprising thing is that furthermore we define K using the ADS length scale and 4G Newton of the gravity. So this is a gravity language, this is a gravity language, this is a gravity language, and then we define A and A bar and K, okay? Then, gravity action which I mentioned before, where it is, this one, exactly match with this one. Okay, such a simple. It's very surprising. Works. So this is the same as purely Chan-Simon theory in the 3D, okay? Where 3D Chan-Simon is written. So gauge group is SO3, that's what we're saying as SO3, C. Okay? Since, okay, this is assumption one. Since the action is decomposed into holomorphic and the anti-holomorphic part, we assume
the measure for the disintegration of the A and A bar decompose means that it becomes direct product. Now, this is assumption. Nobody can justify directly, but simply because the action is just holomorphic part and anti-holomorphic part, we assume that the measure for the quantum dynamic partial function also decompose, meaning that it's a factorized. That's my assumption. Then we expect the result is that for the holomorphic part, A integration and A bar integration gives a full answer.
So there is no unique definition of the measure by which you can show that this is correct?
Because defining measure is the same as defining the theory, and nobody knows how to.
No, but you have replaced it by some gauge fields, right?
Right. So right. I think. So we know how to define the measure for the chance anniversary, that we know for sure.
Yeah.
But we do not know whether that reproduces the expected quantum gravity function simply because, as he pointed out.
Yeah, so what I mean is that if you define the measure by the standard measure of Chan-Simons
exactly.
theory, then this is
yeah.
not
so,
an assumption. Then this
yeah,
is correct.
Yeah, that's what I will okay. try. Using the known knowledge of the normal Chan-Simons theory is the measure, how much we can reproduce the gravity expected result, that's what we are trying.
But in a sense, isn't that just you're defining what you mean by quantum gravity?
Yeah.
You're
yeah.
just making a definition of what you mean by quantum gravity.
Well, really. Okay, I can make whatever, you can make whatever definition it, but the question is whether really it gives a sensible result of the expected quantum gravity or not. I can say whatever theory is a quantum gravity.
How do you know what is expected?
That's
what okay, that's, yeah. that's we compare with what we can propose. It's a very reasonable argument. Yeah. So whether we can reproduce this result or not, that's what we like.
Okay.
okay. As a question? Okay, so far? So a few comments. So even though we have assumed to be A3, we still have the slightly more depth of freedom that is represented in the dual field theory as the Virasoro algebra. So what do I mean by that? We assume any diffeomorphism in the bulk, which is decaying in the boundary. Okay? As long as it's decaying in the boundary, it's consistent with asymptotic A3 boundary condition. You can quantize this fluctuation, and then you obtain exactly the Virasoro algebra, which is expected in the boundary 2D CFD. Okay? And Brown and Hainaut worked out such a thing long time ago before the CFD, and then they identified the central charge of the dual field theory is related somehow by the AdS main scale and G quantum, and that's exactly using this definition of the K, okay, is 6 times K. So, using this, Pauli formula gives a BDG black hole entropy in the large limit. That's what Stoneyzer did after the ADCFT. The surprising point of the Brown-Hainaut before the ADCFT noticed the similarity between ADS3 and the CFT.
Are you making some assumption about the boundaries? Is it ADS3 or mod?
Well, boundary is ADS3.
Global things, I mean, you can have.
Okay, so boundary is, I'm always considering the final temperature and the Euclidean. So it's periodic in both, so boundary yeah. is compact one on the phi direction, and furthermore, because I assume that it's a finite temperature partial function incident, so it's also periodic in the Euclidean time direction. So boundary, I'm assuming torus.
Okay, so you can allow also conical defects. Conical defects
In conical defect in the bulk, genetically we should include it, and that's what we discussed.
Okay.
Okay, so far? Okay, so a few side issues that SL2C, because it's the same as SO2C1, that's a symmetry of the AS3, is locally the same. If we naively believe in the gauge group with SL2C, then the Chan-Simons theory you have it, as if you are just dealing with the Chan-Simons theory in the bulk, can give the quantization, K should be integer. But as I said, there's some global issue, okay, between this. And now, roughly speaking, SO3,1 is 2 times 2 times of the SO2C. 2 into SU2, SO3, and so on, twice. So it's actually, we can argue it should be K over 4. That's because of the global difference. Okay? So that's reasonable. And this is the C central charge, which Brown and Hainaut derived. And then I define K in terms of this continuum, that becomes 6 times K. And since K is 4 times integer, central charge in pure gravity should be 24 times integer. That's what we expect. Okay? So what is the condition? K is defined in terms of the AdS scale and G Newton. Okay? C is related to this by Brown-Hainaut argument. Okay? So C is related to the K. K should be quantized from the Chan-Simons viewpoint.
And that means that she should be 24 times an integer. So what we did, okay? So this is a picture, when norm means a big digit black hole, we have the gap. Vacuum mass on the big digit black hole is only in this range, okay? But we have the brown halo type of the fluctuation, that is represented by the Virasoro algebra, okay? So Virasoro descendant of the vacuum does exist. That's simply small fluctuation in the bulk, which is decaying in the boundary, and that gives a different state. But that's all determined by the vacuum and the Virasoro algebra. Okay? So there is such a state. So what should be the expected partition function of the bulk? This diagram is written. So he focuses on the current point. The vacuum energy, minus 1 over 18 newton, can be written in terms of Xi in this way. So we use the relation between G newton and Xi. Okay?
Sorry, can I just ask
the question?
What sets the scale between these little, between going?
This and this?
No, that I understand. Between
this and this.
That one, yeah.
Let's see, so G newton. Okay, so
in terms of the mass, it must be the ADS.
I think it's the ADS scale, exactly. The ADS scale.
It's a number.
So ADS scale.
Oh, okay.
So G newton is very tiny, so this gap is huge. Mm-hmm. And this is ADS scale. Okay, so the vacuum energy, this is huge if G newton is zero in the classical limit, can be written as a large central charge over the L, and that can be written by using the difficult mathematical. Okay, 1 over 12 is written as 1 over 24 times 1 over 24. Okay, now look, this is familiar form of the zero energy of the holomorphic theory. So we defined that, suppose assumption of the holomorphic factorization is correct. Okay, vacuum energy comes from the holomorphic part and the anti-holomorphic part. Each part has a nice formula of the Xi over 24. The partition function of the holomorphic part is written like this. Okay, F0 minus Xi over 24 coming from this vacuum energy. So partition function of the holomorphic part should be written like this. Okay, minus Xi over 24 came from the 1 over 8 G newton, but split it into holomorphic part and anti-holomorphic. Now, the partition function is written in this form, okay? Suppose you calculate in the dual field theory, assuming that it exists, okay? What is the expected result, okay? We obtain something like this. So, if you consider the vacuum, okay, L0, 0, energy is minus Xi over 24 from the vacuum, okay? The rest is, as I mentioned, Brown-Hinnow work of the Balmer module of the vacuum, okay? That determines the spectral component. And all of the BTG black hole does influence only by this range. Okay? H is positive. Meaning that it at most gives a pole of the Q to the zero or higher. Okay? Never gives a Q to the negative power. Because BTG black hole does exist only in this range. Okay? So this structure is uniquely determined by the vacuum and Balmer module of the vacuum. The structure we expect is a pure ADS. Okay? Because BTG black hole, that's a complicated primary operator we expect, does exist only after the gap. This structure is uniquely determined by the symmetry of the theory and then vacuum structure. As a result, partition function, what we expect for the holomorphic part, has a nice structure. Its pole structure is uniquely determined by the vacuum and its Balmer module only. Okay? This part is influenced by the BTG black hole corresponding to some primary, but that doesn't influence to here, Q to the negative at all. Okay? So that's the structure. This is determined by the vacuum and Balmer module of the BTG. Okay? These guys is influenced by the primary corresponding to the BTG black hole, that we do not know generally. So he proposed, or he coined the name, for the extremal shift, which is defined as a partition function, is given in terms of the following structure. All of the poles of the Q to the negative power are uniquely fixed by the central charge of the vacuum of the CFD, and then there are lots of the primary associated with the Q to the positive power, but which doesn't contribute to the pole at all. Okay? So if you have such a CFD, okay, you coin as an extremal CFD. The question to me is that with reasonable assumption of the passive integration measure, can we reproduce this excisional shifting as a function? That's the question we ask now. Okay, it's clear so far. Okay, so the Sheikov 24 case, he gives the answer from this assumption. The structure of the pole is like this, which is Sheikov 24. Okay. And then with a modular invariance, the rest is uniquely determined, up to some constant which he can determine. Similarly for C48, the structure of the function, the vacuum structure is q^-2, that came from the vacuum. And then Bergman module doesn't use the additional ball in this case, the rest is determined from the modular invariance. Okay? So C24 case, this specific combination is called the J function. And in this case, there is a known candidate for the dual field theory, which is worked out by this mathematician. And it's too technical, so I don't do it. But at least it exists in Sheikov 24 case. Okay? So anyway, what we have to do is have to calculate the Bergman quantum wave function with reasonable assumption of Chan-Simon language, Chan-Simon field theory language, and then ask how much we can reproduce this result. Okay? Okay, so how much time do we have? Half an hour. Okay. So the strategy is as I showed. Now I'm going to talk about the detail. Okay. So in step one, we have the classical equivalence. We write down everything with the gravity in terms of the bulk through Chan-Simon theory. Okay, this is the map which I already mentioned. Now, I'm introducing the auxiliary field to make it supersymmetric. Now, this is slightly cheating because you modify your theory into the new theory by adding auxiliary fields. Okay? Generically, if you add the auxiliary field, which is not dynamic, okay? Like this, a fermion with some mass term, no kinetic term, okay? It doesn't change the mass integration. We just added that as a constant term. So we expect, in the beginning, we naively expect, probably because this is not dynamical, just in adding the auxiliary field, integrated over the lambda, it just gives a constant. It doesn't change the path integration at all. So we are okay. That is our assumption in the beginning. Okay? Later we discuss why this is not precise in detail. This actually introduces a boundary localized rhythm freedom. Okay? But for a moment, we assume that this is okay for a moment and see how much we can take. Okay? So by adding the auxiliary fermion and boson, this is because this is auxiliary field, we expect it doesn't change anything. So that's assumption for a moment. Therefore, we expect this doesn't change your theory. Now with this, let's calculate the path function. So far we discuss classical action equivalence to here and here, and then with the assumption of the non-dynamic equilibrium, it doesn't change. So now this is the ugliest part of my talk. We discuss about the measure of the Chan-Simon viewpoint. Okay? So in step one, we have discussed action equivalence, meaning that it's a classical equivalence, but we have not discussed path integral measure yet. Okay? So let's discuss it, since we are doing the quantum theory rather than classical theory. We need to define the measure of the quantum gravity in terms of the Chan-Simon theory language, in terms of the A and A bar, such that gravity path integral can be calculated in terms of the Chan-Simon theory path integral. Okay, that's what we are hoping. Now, there's a sub issue between, there's a sub difference between Chan-Simon theory and gravity. Okay, this is the issue. Okay? This is our reason. Chan-Simon theory lives on three-dimensional Euclidean space, which we call it M. Okay, what is this M? Okay. So far, we just use a classical delighting of the action. Okay. The problem is that the gravity is defined with some asymmetric boundary condition. But the metric for the geometry is mapped into Chan-Simon gauge boson A. But Chan-Simon gauge boson A lives on some manifold. So what is a manifold to define what Chan-Simon theory? Generically, what people believe is that whatever the geometry you consider, whatever the topology you consider in the gravity side, become the topology of the manifold on which Chan-Simon theory is living. Okay, that's what we expect. So what is the N? What is the structure of N? Okay, since it's a chance emission is topological, we don't care the detail of the manifold M's local metric. We care only its topology of the M because it's a topological theory and its boundary metric of the M. This is chance emission topological. Since we solve the quantum relativity asymptotic ADS boundary condition in the Euclidean signature, as he asked, boundary condition of the Euclidean ADS3 gives a torus. Torus is parameterized by just two parameters, its complex modulus and its scalar modulus, size and its shape. Okay? Since size of the torus is just redefinition of the radial coordinate, it doesn't matter. So only the shape does matter. That's what we call the complex modulus, tau or the torus. Okay? So the partition function of the Chang-Simons theory has only the boundary torus complex structure, tau only. Okay? And its topology of the manifold M. Whatever geometry we have because of the partial gravitational gravity, it should have the boundary torus and its torus shaped tau. Depend on the tau, we should obtain the result. That's what it looks. So the different space-time topology, okay, so note that in different space-time topology interactive side should be mapped into different topology M of the Chang-Simons. So this is what I say. Given the geometry, given the gravity, in the path integration, you sum over all of the geometry in the bulk with boundary condition that the metric become boundary torus in the asymptotic ADS region. Okay? But in the bulk, there's a huge topology because of mass integration. And that huge variety of the topology is mapped into the huge topology of the N manifold M on which Chang-Simons theory is living. Okay? But Chang-Simons theory must live on the topology M, whatever topology it is, with whatever handle it is. It should have the boundary torus specified by the tau. Okay? So for the correspondence to work, we have to deal with something algebra. Okay, so what is algebra? In the Chang-Simons theory or in the Gauss theory, if you define Chang-Simons theory on different topology, generically you regard these two as different theory. Extreme theory on the sphere, Wallis theory on the sphere, and Wallis theory on the torus, we regard as a different theory. In the case of the string theory, automatically you have the sum over all of the handles. But these are generically regarded as a different theory. But in gravity, these must be incorporated automatically so that all of the path integration of the geometry should take into account the summing over all of the topology. But Chang-Simons theory, since it's a field theory, they regard different topology theory. The Chang-Simons theory living on the different topology is regarded as a different theory. So the ugly part of here is that you have to sum over by hand in order to match with the expected result of the gravity. So, okay, we need to sum over different topology for N on which Chang-Simons theory live. We sum over them by hand. Okay? So this is somehow some input.
Do you have a classification of all possible topologies?
Yes.
Yes. This is a three-dimensional surface, no?
Yes.
How do you have a classification?
Okay, with the asymptotic boundary condition, and furthermore, we do the localization technique, and that with a further restriction, with that, we can justify what is the necessary geometry to do this. Mm-hmm. That's it. I come to that point. Mm-hmm. Another question? Okay, so furthermore, in Chang-Simons theory, boundary condition related by the modular transformation for tau are regarded as a different theory. And here is again, since we are dealing with the gravity, where the moduli tau is related by the modular transformation, we usually regard as the same theory in the gravity. We have to do it summing over by hand. These two are. Okay, so all of the blah 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 argument is written in this form. So gravity path integration, okay, we split into the sector, meaning that corresponds to different topology by hand. In gravity path integration, these must be incorporated automatically. But for the field theory correspondence, we do it by hand. So different topology, but all of them must have the boundary torus with tau. But inside the bulk, there's so many varieties of the topology. We split it into the sector of the topology, and therefore each sector of the topology, we map into Chang-Simons theory, with Chang-Simons theory is living on the specific topology, okay, with boundary torus, and then the rest is the bulk. We supersymmetrize, and then we do the calculation, and then how much we obtain the result in the
which is expected from the written supplement. So this is a related question. So we have to sum over all of the topology having the same boundary to a star and its modular transformation. Now, how can we do that? It's a different question. But here, the localization argument gives some hint. So one can show that, so this is a localization. So as I said, Chan-Simon theory is supersymmetrized because adding the original frequency to anything. And this is actually equivalent to adding this T supermodular theory because one can show that this action is actually T independent. Okay?
So when Witten did these similar things 10 years ago, he was not supersymmetrizing, right? So that's where now you start improving.
Now we are doing different.
Because I think they got stuck. I mean, there were some issues there. With
yeah, so actually, what Witten did, and after that, Witten and Maloney actually did, after that, what they find is that their partial function they obtain doesn't give that sensible result. In the sense, the number of the primary become like fractional or negative or something. It doesn't have the well defined nature expected from the field theory. So they say, okay, this doesn't work.
And the problem was the sum over the modular.
They also sum over by hand. What they do is that they sum over all of the saddle point of the gravity by hand, and they do the one loop pass integration, and they sum over all of them, and then they ask, does this give the sensible shift interpretation? The answer is no. Okay. That's a
but now the localization.
Now localization is slightly different approach. Mm-hmm. It gives more of the justification of doing the semi-classical approximation, and then again, and then we sum over, and then what is the result that we ask? Okay, so one can show that this is the same. T independent, you use a localization argument, and then, so this is zero, so in T equal infinity limit, T equal infinity limit, since this partial function is actually T independent, use a localization argument, only this SN limits, which we added, equal zero configuration dominate. Okay? So this is one of the beautiful things of the correspondence. If you look at the SN limits, was zero. Okay, then at least for the bosonic part, that corresponds to f mu nu goes to zero. Now, if you go back to the original language of the Weyl-Bain and then speed connection, this f mu nu equals zero, which corresponds to localization locus, is exactly the same as Einstein equation, but with complexified variable. Why you have a complexified variable? Simply because we assume a and a bar is holomorphically factorized. That's a big assumption. And because of that, it's become Einstein equation exactly, but with complexified version. So this is a good point. Localization uses a justification of the semi-classical approximation somehow. Okay? If mu equals zero, only that contribute, and that's the same as Einstein equation. Okay? Now this is the point. Since all of the solutions of the Einstein equation contribute as a localization locus, and all of the locus is the same as Einstein equation with its complexified version, or meaning that analytically continued version. And since all of the known solution, or actually we can argue that all of the solutions of the Einstein equation in 3D is topologically the same as solid torus with boundary condition that boundary is torus. Actually, topology is highly distributed, meaning that there are many of the topology, but if you ask what is the contribution which contribute to the localization locus, all of them is solid torus topology only. There's many other ones, but that doesn't contribute to the localization calculation. So we don't care. So we have to sum over, but because of the localization of the locus, only the one which does matter or which does contribute is the solid torus topology. So the issue of the summing over all of the topology is now gone, and we have to sum over only the solid torus only. That's a nice point of the localization. Okay. Now the rest is straightforward. We sum over all of the tau or its modular transform related one. Okay. There are many people worked out. Okay, Maloney and Witten also did that. But the approach is that they consider the saddle point without compression, saddle point, and then summing over all of the modular transformation by hand, doing the one loop just one loop calculation, and then they find the result is inconsistent. But we are doing a bit different. We pass integration over this one, and then summing over all of the modular transformation into quantity, and ask what is the limit. So, solid torus is the same as donuts with inside. Okay, I'm not going to okay, there's a many contribution. Okay, what we are doing is that, okay, so we have to
do the partition function calculation with this quantity, with the solid progress topology in chance. Now, fortunately, these people have worked out such a thing with totally different motivation. So that condition, they require that the supersymmetry boundary condition consistent with a directly boundary condition at the boundary torus. Okay. Now they worked out what should be the appropriate boundary condition at the torus, boundary torus, and they worked out this should be the boundary condition. Now metric map to the gauge boson. So from the geometry, we can read out what should be the tempted values A of the gauge boson. And then with directly boundary condition, we can do the batch function calculation. So I don't show the detail of the calculation, these people did it, taking that one. So the result is the following, simply saying that the classical contribution of this one, that's the same as Einstein action with complexified sudden gives this contribution, and then one loop. And the only one loop is justified by the localization. Okay? So this is completely dominant. Everything is detailed in terms of the bounded value. That's what we show. And then we sum all the modular transformation related to quantity by hand. Okay? So what do we obtain? In gen, after the long calculation, okay, this integration, what we obtain in gen is foreign. So after the summing over all of the modular transformation related quantity, okay, for the each sector, we do the calculation, only the solid torus contribution dominate as the localization locus. Other of the topology doesn't contribute because of localization. After the calculation, after the long calculation, what we obtain in GN is the following result. The result is that our partition action, assuming holomorphic factorization, G of the holomorphic part is written as some for the Lagrimarca function or whatever you call it, with some coefficients like defined. That's the result. So what is this result? What is this function? That's defined in the some complicated one, but everything is in Euclid time. So interpretation. So as I said, C is 24 times integer G. Suppose C is 24, what do we obtain? Okay? The result is J function plus some constant. Okay? Except for the constant term, this is exactly what the J function. But this is not so surprising. Okay, this is what actually we can argue that it should be J function. But simply because we sum over all of the modular transformation related topology by hand. So from the modular transformation of the symmetry, okay, modular invariance guarantee we obtain the J object. Now we ask, what is the result if C is 48? That's the next one. Okay? The result we obtain is a form of partition function is q to the minus 2 minus q to the minus 1. Okay? This minus 1 is actually boson because this is different from extremal CFT partition function. Extremal CFT partition function, which we can argue, doesn't have this. So our result is different. Okay. So there's a several possibility of the interpretation. Okay? Possibility is zero. We make some mistake. Okay? We always have some possibility, but suppose we don't do that. Now, two possibilities. Dual extremal CFT with temporal charge 48 does not exist because it doesn't produce the extremal CFT partition action, which we can argue that. Okay? His argument is that the vacuum and all the pore structure is determined by vacuum and its polynomial. It doesn't show it. Just from the argument of the mass gap, this is the expected result. Our calculation doesn't reproduce that. So the possibility is that dual extremal CFT does not exist. That's a possibility one. And it, maybe in some sense it's reasonable because nobody knows how to construct such extremal CFT with she is 48. She is 24, people know it. She is 48, nobody knows it. Okay? That's a possibility one. Now, there's a second issue. Dual CFT may exist, but it is not pure gravity. Why is not pure gravity? This is the point which, okay. This is the point which the shadow. So there's actually, our theory is not pure gravity because we...
Just a question about...
So the point is that we added the Fermi-Minkowski degrees of freedom, even though they are not dynamical. Actually, if you look at our theory in detail, it slightly modifies the degrees of freedom. And it added that the degrees of freedom living only in the boundary. So it's slightly modified from the pure gravity that we will discuss from now on. But before that, let me conclude so far. So if that calculation is possible with several assumptions, okay, what is the assumption?
Okay. We use a localization. We assume phasor moas as adding the fermion because it's auxiliary, it doesn't change your theory at all. That's my assumption. Then we sum over modular transformed tau by hand. Okay. All of the argument was Witten, Witten, and Dirac, and so on, so on. Okay. Fairly Taylor and so on. They also sum over by hand. So in that sense, we are as bad as they do. We have to sum over because chance time theory with modular transformed tau is regarded as a different theory. But we have to sum. The nice point of our argument is that because of the localization, only the solid torus topology does contribute, can be justified. Our result for the CIS24 is the same as the function. But that's not so, so surprising because we assume the modular transformation, modular invariance by hand. Question?
Well, we could ask about the fermions, but I guess you can answer. My question was if that modifies the Brownian argument. And then that's the C, the value of C, but I guess you're gonna
okay.
You're gonna go. With it.
But for C equals 48, then you disagree with it?
No, C equals 24, it's guaranteed. 24
is a function,
so no guarantee. And in this case, there's a dual shift, it does exist, that we know for sure, so no contradiction.
But for 48, do you get the same answer or different?
No, 48, we don't get exponentiated much. So our result for the C equals 48 is that Q to the minus 2, that's the same. But we have additional minus Q to the inverse. That is different from the XML CFT. XML CFT says that Q to the minus 2, and then Balmer module doesn't allow such a term at all. So it's different. Okay, so boundary, finally, I just like to mention the boundary theorem argument, and then I finish. Okay, so what is the boundary contributors? So we do the localization for the solid torus. We impose a supersymmetric boundary condition, including the introduced auxiliary fermion of degrees of freedom. And the boundary condition is determined consistent with Dirac's boundary condition and the supersymmetry. Okay? So the boundary condition is given by this one. But if you look closely at this boundary condition is actually incompatible with the Gaze Nomas term which introduced. Actually, if you look at this condition into here, lambda bar lambda only at the boundary, actually disappears. So we introduce such a term in the bulk of the chance theory, but this supersymmetric directly boundary condition prohibits such a mass term for the lambda at the boundary. Since there's no quantum term, but since mass term also disappear, this indicates there is an additional degrees of freedom living only at the boundary. Okay? And the detail of the argument is a bit technical or wrong, but roughly speaking, this is the same as boundary localized fermion in the domain of the stuff. Okay? So,
but then why do you give the right answer for C equal to 24?
C equal to 24, actually, we can argue the number of the boundary fermion is proportional to the content of the, our algebra. Okay? And then in the case of the SL2, this actually number gives a slightly complicated contribution. And then we don't have the sharp answer, but C equal 24 case, I think the answer is so much restricted by the modular transformation, meaning that the C equal 24 case, the only pole you have is Q inverse. And then whatever you have, the rest doesn't give the Q to the negative pole at all. So C equal 24 case, the theory is so much restricted. So whatever mistake you did, in general, it doesn't influence the answer. So C equal 24 is in some sense very similar to judge whether what you did is correct or not. Because modular transformation is so strongly constraining your partition function. The real question is that if C is 48 or higher, whether you get the sensible answer or not, that's the real question. So now we argue, we say that there's a boundary over the fermion. It's living only in the boundary torus. Okay? Now we have to get rid of this guy in order to obtain the sensible result for the pure gravity contribution only. Now, there is a big assumption. We do not know what is the partition function of these boundary localized fermions. Okay? So we just guessed it. Okay? Once we guess its contribution zero, this free fermion contribution, we divide it to remove the contribution to the boundary fermion. And then we define this new quantity as a pure contribution of the boundary gravity. And then from now on, I discuss what is this. So after the
sediment mass soluble equation, we can show that this quantity, after adding in the boundary minimum contribution, is written like this. Mm-hmm. It's a very nice formula. So it's written as a Verma modulo of the vacuum, and then Verma modulo from the all of the primary with Q to the positive power. And then we can show that all of the coefficient here is positive and integer. Remember that in the case of the Mann-Witten, they derived the partial function this way, and this quantity is not integer, not necessarily positive, and then they give up as a shift interpretation. But in our case, this quantity is always positive. This is the number of the primary we expect. It's always positive. And also it matches in the large delta limit with the Cauchy formula of the black hole entropy. So it's always positive and integer. Okay, so from our first function, okay, detail doesn't matter, we can exactly identify what this C should be, and it's become like this. It's always positive and integer and satisfies Cauchy formula. So nice. Okay, so I was done what I want to say. So the summary, exact calculation is possible with several assumptions. Especially with the localization technique, we can show the result of the CP24 is the same as J function. Okay. Now, the resultant partial function for the homework part is written in complicated formula. The formula doesn't matter. Suppose we believe in the partial function, the boundary localized Fermi-Fermi boundary localized Fermi-Fermi is given as previous formula. Our result is this formula. It's a nice formula. Everything is a Verma module of the vacuum. And then Verma module of the primary, this coefficient is always positive integers. Never become negative at all. Whatever delta, whatever k effective you take it. All of what I say can be extended into higher spin gravity. So vibration is SL2C, that's the same as local SO3.1. Higher spin gravity in AD3 dimension, asymptotic AD3 is defined as generalizing SL2 into SLN. Okay? Straightforward, the result is simply replaced by the Villas algebra, is replaced by the Dublin symmetry, extending showing the Cauchy formula in the large symmetry limit. Everything works similarly. So just an example, SL2 is the same as before, SL3, this is a higher spin with spin 3 is included, partial function is okay. N equal 4 correspond to higher spin with spin 4 periods included, partial function is calculated, and so on, which are calculated. The resulting partial function, as I mentioned, the number of the boundary fermion is proportional to the Cartan algebra, so divided by n minus 1. This form of the G is we are guessing. But how much we obtain fermion, n minus 1, we can show it. So again, using this one, straightforward, we obtain, and the result is this one. Only this is a nice formula. This is actually the Verma module over the vacuum of the Dublin CF formula. And this is the Verma module of the primary of the Dublin CFT. And then C delta, again, we can show it's all positive integers. So it's as a nice, reasonable CFT interpretation. Again, but the assumption is that what is the partial function of this boundary of this fermion? We just guessed it. This is an input.
That's right. I thought for higher spin we don't need any boundary fermions, at least for large C, no? I mean, isn't that the Kupak-Fumer radial story?
Right, but what we did is we make our higher spin theory into the Chan-Simon language, which defined the group, and then we make it supersymmetric. This supersymmetrization, we are slightly modifying our theory,
yeah.
And by this supersymmetrization, it turns out we added up the boundary of the. And that gives the difference between pure gravity to slightly different
set. But for higher spin, you didn't need to supersymmetrize, right? At least for large C. Or
for the large C, yes. But we have to see everything in the small C. Okay, I'm done. So all the results can be generated with the higher spin gravity instead of the Virasoro, we obtain everything with a nice formula over the double symmetry. Okay, compared with other trivial, all of the C, the number of the primary, can be shown to be integer, whatever delta, whatever k effective, as is consistent with the quantum condensation with what we can argue. It's nice integer, so it looks like nice. So as I said, possibility of the C equal 48 or higher is that either duration does not exist, okay, as a pure gravity, or in order to make the theory well defined, okay, you will be completion senses. We have to modify from pure gravity to a delta boundary fermion.
And if this is a correct topomera, it modifies because we have additional units because of the superparametrics. But once we add means R, we have less. That's what we are. Every single consistent. The diversity. So, that's it. Thank you.
Any further questions?
So, by adding fermions, I would have thought that you would change the value of C.
Change of the part, yeah, we actually modify slightly by adding the change of the. So, everything we do instead was a K, K effective. So, originally I define.
I see, okay.
Yeah, K is original K from the defined. Just
I see, okay.
Yeah, K is defined by G Newton and L. But now it's slightly modified. K become K effective with some additional correction by
so the it, okay, so the C equals 6K effective or six C equals 6K? That's why I can't remember.
Yeah, so this is slightly modified.
Oh, okay, C is 6. Okay. So you sort of added fermions and taken away the boson yeah. Degrees of freedom.
What is the
Fermion
of
Fermion?
I mean, perturbation was a...
I'm just saying that the equivalence seems to work in perturbation theory and the non-perturbative part about like equating the partition functions itself. Was, is that an assumption or...
I'm
just saying that the equivalence between the SL2 to the two factors, the bulk ADS3 quantum gram and the bulk Chern sinus
okay.
Was only perturbation.
Well, at least what we know for sure is that the classically they are equivalent. But quantum mechanically, we do not know the equivalence at all. So what we did in our approach is that we assume some measure of the gravity in terms of the Chern sinus language, and then ask, because we assume something, right, about the measure of the Chern sinus in order to reproduce the quantum energy partition function. From the result, how much we obtain the expected result, which we didn't argue. That's what we did. So at least the non-equivalence is only classical. Our approach is we do not know what is the appropriate measure of the quantum gravity. In terms of the Chern sinus language, we propose some measure and then compare the result with expected result. That's what we did. Of what we think argued. Of the extremal CFT, whether we can reproduce or not. That's what we did.
Because the
extremal CFT is somehow okay. Either with the argument is correct or not, we do not know, but with reasonable argument, we can reproduce them. That's what we discussed.
Was there some paper by Maloney and company where there was some argument that the argument was not correct about the extreme activity, the monster?
I'm
very unaware of this, but I thought that like, there was some paper by Alex Maloney and his collaborators.
Okay. Yeah, so what, okay, so actually you are talking about the Maloney-Witten's argument. So after Witten proposed this one, so Maloney with Witten did the following thing. They consider quantum gravity partition function because they cannot calculate. They just look at the, what is the all of the saddle point of the pure gravity. Just solving the Einstein equation, okay? Either ADS3 or lots of the BTG black hole solution, okay? And many of them is related by the modular transformation. What they did is that take the saddle point, plug it into the pure gravity action, that gives a reading of the saddle point. In addition, you can determine what is a one loop determinant around the saddle point. And then by hand, they sum over all of the tau related by the modular transformation. And then they propose, is this well-defined partition function or not? They write it down as we did it, the final partition function, they write it down like this one. So this suppose this is what they did. Saddle point with one loop, and then summing for all of them by hand. And then they ask, this can be written in this form or not. Yes, but this C is not necessarily positive and not necessarily integer. So they say, well, this doesn't give a well-defined shift interpretation. But in our approach, we can do this a bit different way. In our case, this is positive and integer. That's the difference. because we calculate from different approach, because nobody knows how to define a gravity directory. Our approach is in chance language with Marlin assumption, using the localization, calculated this quantity. Maroney and Witten did is that just take the saddle point of the all the Einstein equation solution, plug in addition, added up the one loop determinant, and then write down this in this way and ask this C is positive or integer. In the approach, no. Large K. Yeah, large K corresponds to the classical limit.
So, one last question. So this partition function for the boundary fragments? Basically, you chose the simplest possible thing you could think of. Right?
Yeah.
But have this you tried any other possibilities that could also give you integers?
Yeah.
But do you have a way of saying this is unique? No, right?
It's not unique.
Okay.
So in some sense it's a slight ambiguity, yeah. But as a boundary gradient function is 1 minus q to something, it doesn't change the integer property at least.
Yeah.
Whether it changes positivity or not, okay, generically we expect it doesn't change. So it's more or less, we can show it generically,
yeah.
But my guess is that this is very robust. Even though we have a guess,
mm-hmm.
If we modify it drastically boundary gradient function, of course this change is modified. But with our reasonable guess of the boundary localized domain one equilibrium, this is a different assumption, and then this.
But there is a statement that to properly quantize bosonic gravity, you need to add Fermi to the boundary.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the statement? That to properly you have something purely bosonic,
mm-hmm.
But then to make sense of it, you need to add this boundary.
Yeah,
Fermi.
So I said two possibilities. Either dual circuit doesn't exist,
yeah.
Or without additional degrees of freedom to make the UV complete. Just by pure gravity, it doesn't exist. So these are two possibilities. Adding extra user noise to make it special.
Yeah, but these are fermionic degrees of
yeah, fermionic.
That's what could be called. Could you bosonize them? They're 2D fermions. So
maybe.
Okay, let's thank Nori again. And let's just, 1 minute, let's go out and take a picture just here by the table.